Hachette Digital presents Keep the Home Fires Burning by Cynthia Harrod-Eagles, read by Annie Aldington. Chapter 1. The December of 1914 had been mild but wet, and Flanders was a flat place. Here, at Ypres, the British Army had ended the race to the sea, denying the Germans that last crucial fragment of Belgium and the Channel ports. The salient in front of the city was crisscrossed with streams and dikes. Now they were full, and as the water continued to fall from the sky, it made no distinction between a drainage channel dug by farmers and a trench dug by soldiers. It poured into both. There was little movement beyond the occasional flight of birds from one battered stand of trees to another, or a wisp of smoke from one of the few farm cottages still occupied, climbing reluctantly into the damp, foggy air, grey on grey. The thousands of soldiers who invested the landscape were invisible, gone to ground. On both sides, they dug in to try to make the best of things, shore up their defences and wait for better days. There wasn't much to do in the trenches. Apart from dawn and dusk stand-tos, there were only routine inspections and maintenance duties. For the rest of the time, Jack Hunter read anything he could lay his hands on. Books were precious in the front line, but also fragile in the relentless damp, and wrote long letters to his wife. In fact, it was more like one long letter, sent off in sections as chance, the postal collection, or running out of paper, dictated. "I've been rereading your account of Christmas," he wrote on New Year's Day. "Glad to know London is still humming. I can just imagine all those restaurants and clubs bursting at the seams, the dances and parties, the taxicabs crammed with revellers. The top brass were furious about our Christmas truce, but our colonel was glad of the chance to mend the barbed wire, bail out the trenches and bring in the dead. They've been mouldering out there since November, making us all feel rather fed up. Orders from on high say no more fraternisation. We must all shoot to kill from now on. In fact, hardly anyone shoots at all. What Tommy in his right mind would poop off at an invisible enemy when it means hours of cleaning the rifle afterwards? I expect the Boche feel the same, because they've been quiet all week. So we were surprised last night when there was a sudden ferocious fusillade from the trenches opposite. Couldn't think what had come over them, unless they had some choleric general visiting. There was nervous speculation on our side about a new campaign of night raids, until some wise person, yes, it was me, remembered that our 11 p.m. is their midnight. They were ringing in the new year, and courteously firing well above our heads so that we shouldn't get the wrong idea. An hour later, we returned the compliment, after which it all went quiet again. By one of those unsought miracles familiar in army life, we had a new pump delivered, despite not having asked for one. It is much more efficient than the old one, and we are finally pumping out more water than is coming in, so we can see the duckboards again. I have a decentish dugout, and only two more days in the front line, and two in support, before I can get back to the heaven that is Poperanga and a bath. The child Jack would never have believed how much the adult Jack would long to be in hot water. Gibbs has just poked his head in to say that, in honour of the new year, the commissariat have sent up currant duff with dinner, which has just arrived. Also, he has acquired a piece of cheese, best not to ask how, to go with the thimble of port he's been saving for just such an eventuality. So tonight I can report I'm fairly comfortable and shall be well fed, and inconvenienced only by the dampness of the writing paper. That, and being so far away from you, dear love. Not much to do but sleep. Good. And reflect Janus-faced, not so good, as one is obliged to do at the opening of a new year. It has been a strange war so far. Mistakes, setbacks, heroic exertions, swings of fortune, desperate dashes, tremendous stands. Our tiny army has cheated the mighty German machine of what it must have thought was certain victory. And now here we are, where we are, dug in, waiting to see what happens. It occurs to me that the war we all expected and prepared for is actually over. We fought it, and no one won. Now we are facing a new, different war, one that no one imagined, and that no one really knows how to fight. We shall find out, I suppose, when spring arrives and we come out of hibernation. Let's hope 1915 will see a victory as unequivocal as 1815. Then I can come home to you and sink back into the delicious reverie that is our marriage. Dear love, for nothing less than war would I have broke that happy dream, as Dunn almost said. The whole of Northcote was wild with excitement over the engagement between Charles Wharton, Viscount Dean, and Diana Hunter. Diana had been the acknowledged local beauty for too long for anyone to resent her success. Besides, the Wharton's had always been viewed as rather standoffish, and it had been assumed that Charles would eventually marry a titled girl, so it was gratifying that one of their own, so to speak, had conquered the citadel. Visits of congratulation to the Elms began the very next day and went on for the whole week before Christmas. There were even newspaper reporters, polite at the front door and shifty at the back, looking for comments and the story that would appeal to their readers. The servants were thrilled about the engagement, and no amount of extra work answering the door and carrying in trays of tea for visitors dampened their enthusiasm. Cook and Ada were talking about making a scrapbook. Emily sang "They Didn't Believe Me" over and over as she scrubbed floors. Newler had started collecting illustrations of bridal gowns from the magazines and making her own drawings. BT dispensed tea, received congratulations, answered questions, and tried to protect her daughter from the more impertinent intrusions. She found it hard to tell what Diana was thinking. Charles had had to go straight back to his regiment, which lent an air of unreality to the rejoicing. It was no surprise that Diana drifted about like a sleepwalker. Kind visitors had murmured that she was in a daze of bliss. To Beatty, it seemed more like shock. Boxing Day at Dean Park had been a difficult occasion. The Earl, who had a certain efficient charm, raised a toast to our lovely future daughter-in-law. But Lady Wharton had spent so much of her life putting people in their place that it was hard for her to stop now. Her kindest address to Diana had been an undertaking to see what they could do about making her an asset to the house. In addition, there had been Charles's sister, Caroline, and her husband, Lord Grossmore, who seemed unflatteringly astonished about the whole thing. Charles's younger brother, Rupert, who managed to make a smile look like a sharp weapon, and a number of Wharton relatives, who simply didn't know how to talk to people they didn't know, and worse, had never heard of. The older ones appeared to be wondering how on earth such people had managed to get into the house. As the Hunters descended from the motor car that had been sent for them, Beatty had seen her daughter stop and look up at the portico. With its four massive Corinthian pillars and stark, undecorated pediment, imposing was the adjective most often used by guidebooks. Dean Park dated from 1680. And the Whartons of the time had chosen the least fancy of Palladio's designs, with the intention of intimidating visitors rather than enchanting them. As Diana stared, rather white, Beatty could guess her thoughts. To Charles, it would just be the entrance to his home, and he would notice it no more than Diana noticed the porch over the front door at the Elms. The gulf between their two worlds was there before them, encapsulated in solid, undeniable Portland stone. It was not just Charles, not just the Earl and Countess and sundry other stiff relatives, but the whole of his world. Friends and endless tiers of cousins, all brought up like him, with habits and language and expectations quite different from those of a banker's daughter. Not just Dean Park, but a house in Norfolk, an estate in Ireland, a hunting box in Leicestershire, and two houses in London. How was Diana, their Diana, to fit in with all of that? Beatty did not confide her doubts to her husband. Dean Park held no fears for him. He dealt daily with the mighty and visited many great houses in the course of business. Besides, he knew the Earl, one of his clients, tolerably well. He had even been invited once or twice to shoot at Dean Park. It would not have occurred to him that there were social pitfalls, even less that his wife and daughter might fear them. But the day after that terrifying Boxing Day had brought relief. A telegram from Charles was followed rapidly by the man himself, bearing apologies for his absence and an engagement ring for Diana. It was a family heirloom, had been his grandmother's, a large round ruby set about with diamonds on heavy gold. Now, suddenly, the engagement became real. The ring was there. Charles was there. Best of all, he said that as it was only 15 miles from camp to the Elms, and he had a fast motor car, he would come and visit whenever he had a few hours off duty, if Mrs. Hunter would allow him. "Come any time," Beatty said. "You don't need to give notice. We're always glad to see you." When Beatty was not worrying about the wedding, with the added complications of the war and how the Rawton element was to be meshed with the Hunter, she was thinking about David. It was hard not to feel hurt that he had planned to spend his leave with the family of his friend, Oliphant. He had said it was because the Oliphant's home in Melton Mowbray was closer to camp, so he would not have to waste his leave travelling. Beatty couldn't help feeling there were other influences at work, which boded her no good. Highclere Farm, as the name suggested, was at the top of a hill, but still the constant rain had created an ocean of mud. Sadie did not normally do the rough work, but with 8 muddy horses to prepare that morning, she insisted on rolling up her sleeves and pitching in. She was excavating the second subject of the morning from its carapace when John Corsi, the veterinary surgeon, appeared at the stable door.
"My goodness, I didn't recognise you for the moment. Is it really Miss Hunter under there?"
Sadie straightened and pushed her hair back with a forearm, adding another streak to her brow.
"They went and rolled, the wretches," she said. "They were put out in the top paddock overnight, but there's a weak place in the hedge, and they broke through and found the lowest, wettest spot in the whole field, and down they went."
John Corsi was laughing now.
"They all looked so pleased with themselves when they were fetched in. I swear this one had a smirk on his face."
"Which one is it?"
"Conker," she said.
The sergeant, Cairns, who had been assigned to them, had warned her not to name them in case she got fond of them. But she'd done it anyway. Conker was her favourite. She slapped his neck affectionately, and he turned his head and nuzzled her.
"It might have been wiser to keep them in overnight," Corsi said.
Sadie looked stern.
"I think we know that now," she said.
She glanced down at herself, then shyly up at him.
"Do I look very dreadful?"
"Not at all. Mud becomes you," he said solemnly.
He had come to examine the 8 horses that were leaving today for the Army Remount Service Depot. 2 of the original intake of 10 had been pronounced not ready by Mrs. Cuthbert. After nearly 4 months of schooling by her, Sadie and the grooms, they were still unreliable, particularly in the face of loud noises. Teaching the youngsters to bear having firecrackers let off near them had been the wildest part of the training process. In the consequent rodeos, Sadie had taken several falls. She'd had to conceal the bruises from her family, for fear she would be forbidden to help any more. Corsi was looking at her with sympathy.
"You're going to miss them," he suggested.
She tried to brazen it out.
"I'm just pleased we've got the first batch ready to go."
"Of course you are," he agreed kindly. "Well, I'd better give them a going over."
He glanced at Conker.
"Perhaps I'll start with the clean ones."
"Conker's the last," she said. "The others are all ready."
"Do you want to leave him for a moment and come with me?" he asked.
"You can hold them for me while I look them over." She agreed readily, pleased that he had asked. She loved the way he treated her as an equal, not as a child. At home, they would have disapproved of her muddiness. He just laughed. It was only a pity they didn't see more of him at Highclere. He was attached to the Army Remount Service, so he came whenever they had a veterinary problem. But the Irish horses had been pretty healthy so far. He was also on call for any army units in the area, so she saw him from time to time,
buzzing about in his little car. Sometimes he would stop and have a chat with her, but if he was in a hurry, he would only wave as he passed. Now she went with him, from box to box, holding the horses while he looked at their ears, eyes, teeth and feet, and listened with his stethoscope to their hearts, lungs and stomachs. "You're very good with them," Corsi said. "You make my job much easier."
"They're good fellows," she said, deflecting the praise. She wasn't used to being complimented.
One of the grooms had finished Conker when they got to him. He shoved his nose under Sadie's arm and sighed a great gusty sigh of content as he leaned into her. Corsi thought that despite her plucky words, she would miss them.
"Well, they're fit enough anyway," he said, rolling up his stethoscope. "When are they leaving?"
"The 2:10 train. There's a railway box waiting for them in the siding at Northcote. We're hacking them down."
"You're going with them?" Corsi asked.
"Me, Podrick, Bent and Oxer. Ride one and lead one. Mrs. Cuthbert will follow in the motor to collect the tack."
They stepped outside. Just for the moment, the rain had stopped, though the sky was grey and threatening. Corsi leaned an elbow on the box door and seemed inclined for conversation.
"I don't suppose it'll be long before you get a new batch in," he said. "There's nothing much going on in France at the moment, but they'll want to get up to full strength before any spring offensive."
"Will there be a spring offensive?" Sadie asked quickly.
"Oh, I haven't heard anything," he said. "It's just the way armies work. They can't fight in the current conditions, so both sides will hibernate until spring."
"It seems awfully silly," Sadie said slowly, "to be fighting by rules like that, when fighting itself is such a... I can't think of the right word."
"Such an anarchic thing," he offered.
"Yes," she agreed.
"I suppose it's as well there are rules, or it would be even worse than it is," he said. "You have a brother who's volunteered, I believe."
"David, the eldest," she nodded. "He's in training somewhere near Nottingham. He's longing to get out to France."
"Good for him."
"He wants to do something noble to serve his country," Sadie said with pride.
"You're very fond of him," Corsi noted. She nodded.
"I miss him. Father calls it leaving the nest. He says we'll all hop out sooner or later. I hate the idea of that. I suppose it has to be. But you always hope nice things will stay the same forever, don't you? Christmas was strange without him."
"You're lucky to have brothers and sisters," Corsi said. "There was only ever me at home. The high point of Christmas Day was my father playing a game of chess with me after dinner. Not exactly riot unbounded."
"That's sad for you," said Sadie. "Brothers and sisters are not always completely lovely, but on the whole I'm glad to have them."
"And your sister is engaged to be married," Corsi said.
"How did you hear that?"
"Everyone seems to be talking about it," he said.
"I can guess what they're saying. How amazing that Lord Dean's chosen a nobody instead of a duke's daughter."
"I'm sure they don't say that."
"I'm sure they do, behind our backs."
"Well, not me anyway," said Corsi. "And what do you say?"
"That he's in love with her, and that's all that matters, isn't it?"
"To you and me, perhaps. I believe in Lord Dean's world, other things are usually taken into account. What do you think of him?"
"I've only met him a couple of times, but I like him. He talks very sensibly about dogs, and he was nice to Naylor. Nobody's ever nice to poor Naylor."
"Except you," said Corsi.
"And you."
"It's my job," he said. She knew he hadn't been kind to Naylor, only because it was his job.
"But you like dogs too," she said.
"I like yours," he said.
She met his eyes shyly and had to look away. She'd never been shy with grown-ups, but there was something about John Corsi. At the end of a rapid chain of thought that wouldn't bear inspection, she blurted out,
"It's my birthday on the 20th. I'll be 17.
He raised an eyebrow.
"Should one say congratulations? I'm not very knowledgeable about such things, but I believe 17 is something of a milestone."
"I don't know," she said. "I'm not officially out, but I don't suppose with the war and everything, there'll be the old sort of coming out any more, at least until the war's over."
She looked up at him.
"I do think it's changed things, the war. Don't you?"
"Yes. But whether the changes are permanent, I suppose it depends rather on how long it goes on."
At that moment, Mrs. Cuthbert appeared.
"Everything all right?" she called to Corsi as she approached.
did you find my charges?
In tip-top condition, Corsi answered. I've never seen such a happy bunch of four-year-olds. You must have been tucking them in every night with Coco in a bedtime story.
Then I take it you're signing them off. Good-o. There's a train for them this afternoon.
So Miss Sadie was telling me.
Mrs. Cuthbert turned her eyes on Sadie and noticed the state of her.
My dear girl, you must go indoors and get some of that mud off you at once. I can't have you riding through the public streets like that.
Sadie was embarrassed.
I don't see that it matters. Everyone in Northcourt knows you, and it'll matter if it gets back to your parents and they forbid you to come again. You're not a child any more.
So I've just been told, said Corsi. 17 is a young lady, Miss Hunter.
Young ladies don't do interesting things, she complained. It's nothing but clothes and dancing.
I'm sorry you don't like dancing, said Corsi. I imagine you do it rather nicely.
She thought about dancing with him and was confused. Of course I like it, but it can't be all dancing. There has to be something else to life as well.
Corsi was sorry to have teased her.
I agree. Dancing is far from everything, but it's pleasant while it lasts.
He turned to Mrs. Cuthbert. I'd better complete the documents for this lot.
Yes, of course, said Mrs. Cuthbert, and added to Sadie, go up to the house and have a wash, and ask Annie to brush your clothes and clean your boots. I'll be up in a minute, and look you out one of my clean shirts.
Sadie escaped gratefully, but still couldn't help looking back when she reached the gate for a last sight of John Corsi. But he had turned away with Mrs. Cuthbert, and she only saw his back view.
She felt proud bringing up the rear of the cavalcade, leading Ginger and riding Conker for the last time. The horses were enjoying being out as a group and were trotting nicely, carrying their heads well and keeping pace with each other as if they were on parade. How different they were from the wild bunch delivered back in September. She was particularly proud when a motor car idling at the curb backfired explosively just as they passed and none of the horses missed a beat. As they rode through the streets of Northcote, people turned to look, and those who knew her called out and waved to her. There were quite a few soldiers about. After 5 months, it no longer surprised her, though she always noticed them. The Tommies gave a cheer when they saw she was a girl, and she smiled in response. There were other reminders of the war, too. Red, white and blue bunting round the window of Stein's, the butcher's, portraits of the King and Queen in Hadley's window, the words business as usual on the side of a Simpson's dairy cart going by. On the railings by the police station, there was a recruitment poster, and the advertisement for the Electric Palace in Westley had a new sticker across it saying, Servicemen in uniform, free. As they reached the station yard, the Charrington's coal dray pulled out, drawn by a pair of mules, instead of the lovely shires that had been commandeered by the army. Yes, she thought, clattering into the yard. Though most things seemed much the same as always, you wouldn't have any difficulty in remembering there was a war on. She helped untack and box the horses. They were offered water, but they wouldn't drink. There was a little hay in the rack along one side, and they were more interested in that. It was time to say goodbye, and despite her good intentions, Sadie felt tearful. She left Conker to last, but when she caressed him, he gave her only a perfunctory nudge and continued tugging eagerly at the wisps of hay. Podrick, the head man, was waiting at the foot of the ramp. He gave her a sympathetic look.
They'll be all right, he said.
I know, she said, swallowing the lump in her throat. Podrick, Bent and Oxer were standing by the heap of tack, waiting for Mrs. Cuthbert to arrive and take them back. She felt a sudden desire to be alone, and said, There won't be anything for me to do at Highclere this afternoon. I think I'll go home.
Mrs. will give you a lift, Podrick said.
Oh, no thanks. I'll walk. Will you tell her for me? And with a nod to the grooms, she set off. It started to drizzle when she was halfway home, and a glance at the sky told her proper rain would be setting in soon. She hunched into a collar, put her hands in her pockets, and increased her pace. As she turned in at the gate of the elms, she spotted Naylor sheltering under the laurels. He stuck out his whiskery white muzzle when he saw her, and when she stopped and spoke to him, he came out.
You're soaking, she said.
and he swept his tail back and forth in apologetic agreement. It was getting colder too, and she could see him shivering. "Come on," she said. She managed to sneak him in by the scullery door and used the towel from the sink there to dry him. He went limp in her hands, his eyes closed in bliss, and his jowls flopping as she rubbed him vigorously to warm him up. "You're such a fool," she told him. "Why didn't you shelter?"
"Too much to do," he said in her head, in the growly voice and Hertfordshire accent she always imagined for him. "Places to visit, things to sniff. Don't forget the ears, my girl."
"I'm not your girl. I'm about the only friend you've got, however, except for Mr. Corsi."
"Those are the only ears I've got, so not so rough, my maiden, if you please."
"How's that?"
"Better. So you've been talking with Mr. Corsi, have you? I hope you're not getting spoony on him."
She stopped abruptly, having managed to confound herself. "What a ridiculous suggestion," she said aloud. Chapter 2. David sat at the dinner table at the house of his friend Oliphant, with the rumble of conversation rolling gently over his head. Mrs. Oliphant had invited guests, the neighbours from next door, Colonel and Mrs. Fentiman, and their daughter Penelope. David was seated next to her, and on Mrs. Oliphant's left. Dinner at the Oliphants, when there were guests, was always rather formal, and Mrs. Oliphant did not approve of talking across the table, which meant that David had to divide his attention between Miss Fentiman and his hostess. Miss Fentiman was slightly gingery, with a plump chin and sandy eyelashes, and whether she was dull or merely shy, he didn't know. But it had been hard work to prise anything out of her except yes and no. He'd managed to get over his guilt about not going home. His excuse, that the Oliphant house was closer, was true, but he knew his mother would be upset even so, and he didn't like to upset her. He'd missed them all at Christmas, but he belonged to the army now, and Mother had to realise he was a man and made his own decisions. Anyway, the slight discomfort at the back of his mind, where his conscience lived, was no match for the pleasure of being in the same room as Oliphant's sister, Sophie. At last, the sweet plates were removed and the dessert put on, which meant that general conversation could take place. David abandoned the unrewarding Miss Fentiman and lapsed into silence so he could gaze across the table at Sophie. He thought her the most beautiful girl in the world, and her beauty was only enhanced by comparison with the neighbour's daughter. Sophie was small, delicately made, with dark hair and dark eyes that seemed large in her pale face. Her neck was long and slender and swan-white. He adored her neck. There were one or two tiny curls at the nape, escapees from the confines of her chignon, and he found them utterly distracting. A few weeks ago, some of the men at camp had passed round illicit photographs of women in their underwear, some with their breasts almost uncovered. David had been unmoved by them, but those little curls, with their suggestion of dishabille, could make him go hot and cold in quick succession. Now and then, her eyes would meet his across the table, to be quickly averted, accompanied by a faint blush. It was all the encouragement he needed to keep looking at her, until he accidentally caught Oliphant's eye instead, and his friend gave him a smirk of amusement and a pitying shake of the head, after which he pulled himself together and listened again to the conversation.
"The newspapers are full of nonsense these days," Oliphant Pale was saying. "No proper war news at all. I suppose that's the government's doing, eh, Fentiman? Censorship for our own good." "What the people don't know can't hurt 'em," said Fentiman. "Better to keep up morale."
"Hence all these heartwarming stories, I suppose," said Mrs. Fentiman, "about missing sons turning up and acts of heroism at the front." "I like to read of such things," Mrs. Oliphant pronounced. "There was an account in the newspaper about a soldier who went into a barn to fetch straw and found two armed German soldiers hiding there. He had no weapon with him, but a pair of wire cutters. But most bravely and resourcefully, he pointed them at the Germans and shouted, 'Hands up!' The Germans threw down their rifles and surrendered." "Oh, Mother, that's an old chestnut," Oliphant Junior objected. "It's been around so long it's got whiskers on it." "I don't like that sort of talk, Frederick," Mrs. Oliphant said sternly.
She was a large, solid, well-corseted lady, with iron-grey hair tightly waved in old-fashioned parallel crinkles. Her spectacles magnified her pale eyes to alarming size, and she bent them reprovingly on her son.
"I'm quite sure the story's true, or it would not have been published in the newspaper."
Mrs. Fentiman stepped in, accustomed to her neighbour's literal cast of mind.
"At any rate, it illustrates how plucky and quick-witted our fellows are. A Tommy is worth two Fritzes."
"Quite right," Mr. Oliphant said. "We can all agree about that, at least. But, Fentiman, you have a better source of information than any of us. What's the plan for rolling up the Germans this year?"
"It's a tricky situation," said Colonel Fentiman. "My friend at Horse Guards says the War Council's been considering pulling out of France altogether."
"Surely not," said Mr. Oliphant.
Fentiman nodded.
"The front stretches from the Swiss border to the Channel without a break. And the enemy everywhere is on higher ground. There's no German flank to be turned, and we've already seen that frontal attack is bloody and futile. Those casualty lists in the autumn have rattled the government. It's not at all clear what can or should be done."
"But, sir," said young Oliphant, "the new army will be ready this year. I know we were heavily outnumbered last autumn, but once we Kitchener chaps are ready, surely they'll send us to France to knock Jerry for six. Or what are we training for?"
David wondered the same thing, and looked at Colonel Fentiman with painful urgency. From the beginning, they'd all been afraid the war would be over before they got out there. The Colonel recognised their eagerness. If he had been their age, he'd have felt the same.
"You'll get your chance, all right," he said with sympathy. "But it might not be in France. From what I hear, they're thinking of opening up a new front, out in the east."
Mrs. Oliphant looked puzzled. "In China, do you mean? I didn't know we're at war with the Chinese."
"No, no, dear lady, not quite so far east as that," said Fentiman kindly. "Against Turkey. You must be aware that the Turks have come in on Germany's side. It's unstabilised the whole region. We can't afford to lose the Levant. Greece, Romania, Bulgaria's wavering. We need a show of strength to keep them on our side."
"So, what's the plan, sir?" Freddy Oliphant asked. "To attack Turkey? Take Constantinople and open up the Black Sea route to supply ships. The Russians are up against it, and that will relieve the pressure on them, and, it's hoped, draw the Germans away from France."
"If they take the bait," said Mr. Oliphant. "I never heard that the Germans had any liking for the Turks. They might just decide to let them stew."
"But the Danube, you see, is a back door into Germany. They'd be forced to defend it. At the very least," he finished, with a faint shrug, "opening up a new eastern front would divide their forces three ways."
"It would divide ours too, sir," David said. He had no wish to go to Constantinople and fight Turks. That was not what he had volunteered for.
"Surely our priority must be to drive the Germans out of France."
"That's Sir John French's view," the general said. "But Lord Kitchener is an Easterner by instinct. And Churchill and young Lloyd George are heart set on it, and between them they may carry the argument. Hard fella to argue against, Churchill. And the government wants to avoid another heavy butcher's bill in France. A naval action in the Dardanelles and a quick victory would give them good headlines in the press."
David was shocked at this cynical reasoning. "But, sir," he protested, "we have to knock the Germans out after what they've done."
"We can't just leave them holding half of France," young Oliphant agreed.
Mr. Oliphant smiled.
"You see, Fentiman, how this cub of mine is eager to get to grips with the enemy. He and young Hunter are among the very first volunteers."
"Well done," said Colonel Fentiman. "I like your pluck. But tell me, why aren't you in officer training? Fellows of your calibre ought to be aiming for a commission."
David and Oliphant exchanged a glance.
"We did talk about it. But some of the chaps said ordinary soldiers would get out to France sooner, and if you wanted to have a bash at the enemy, you should stay in the ranks."
"I don't know if that's true or not," David said, with sudden doubt.
"I shouldn't think so for a moment," said the Colonel. "They're desperately short of junior officers, and educated men like you are just what's wanted. You'll get to France all right, but you ought to go as officers. It's your duty."
"It wouldn't make us popular with the CO, David said, with a smile. "He hates losing his prime men, doesn't he, Jumbo?"
"Jumbo?" said Miss Fentiman, looking at him with interest.
"Oh, it's a nickname. Some of the other fellows have started calling me that, said Oliphant.
Mrs. Oliphant turned her gaze on him. I don't understand why.
Well, Mother, Jumbo is what you call an elephant, isn't it?
But our name is Oliphant, not Elephant, she objected uncomprehendingly.
Yes, Mother, I know, said Oliphant patiently. It's, a sort of joke, I suppose.
I don't see how it can be a joke when our name is not Elephant. And I don't believe Elephant is a name at all. I never heard of anyone called it. Certainly not an English person.
David caught Sophie's eyes across the table. They were glinting with laughter, and she was biting her lip, trying not to let it out. He felt a surge of love. He wanted to do something heroic, so that he could lay the deed at her feet as a tribute. He wanted to ride into battle for her, with her favour tied round his arm. Her chevalier sans peur et sans reproche.
Perhaps we ought to put our names forward when we get back, David said to his friend. If you think so, Oliphant said, glad to be rescued from his lexical difficulties. We can but try.
I'd love to see you in officer's uniform, Sophie said. I think the Sam Brown looks so manly. Officers are much more attractive, aren't they, Penny?
Miss Fentiman murmured something in agreement, but Sophie had been looking at David as she said it, and he had no attention for anything else. There was no more doubt in his mind. It was clearly his duty to put down for officer training. Charles came whenever he had a few hours of leisure, and the Elms grew tolerably used to his presence. Even Ada managed to smile and call him Your Lordship when she opened the door to him, instead of becoming scarlet, rigid and tongue-tied. The cautious consensus in the servants' hall was that he was nicer than he first appeared, though to curious outsiders, there were plenty of those, backdoor traffic had never been heavier, they pretended airily that he was like an old family friend now. He came one afternoon, and as it wasn't raining for once, he, Diana and Sadie took Naylor for a walk in the woods. Sadie noticed that Naylor was a different dog in his presence, a meek, seemly, respectful individual, trotting along beside him with the occasional upward glance as if eager to obey his every whim. Diana noticed that Charles was a different person in Sadie's presence. The dog made a useful bridge between them. From dogs, they went on to talk about horses, hunting, country matters in general. Diana had plenty of opportunity to observe him. Though he rarely smiled, there was about him, as he conversed with Sadie, an unaffected kindliness. With Diana, he was still rather grave and stiff. Was it possible, she began to wonder, that his reserve was not hauteur, as everyone supposed? Was it possible that he was merely shy? She had had shy suitors before, but had never supposed Lord Dean, in all his glory, could fall into that category. But if it were true, it put a different complexion on things altogether. She walked in silence, deep in thought. They made a loop through the woods, and coming out onto the main road, Charles suggested they walked into the village. If you're not tired, he gave Diana a solicitous look. It's so good to be out of doors, he added. I seem to spend so much time at a desk these days with reports and records. It was Sadie who said,
It must be awful for you. I hate being cooped up indoors.
Where did Sadie's ease with him come from? Diana wondered. Why didn't she find him overwhelming? When Diana sat with him in the morning room, he was so tall and broad, so very much there, that he seemed to suck all the oxygen from the room. She was suffocatingly aware of his size and presence, and of the silences that often fell between them. It was better out of doors. The open air suited him, and she liked to have her hand on his arm and have people look at them admiringly as they went by. He and Sadie were talking now about the state of agriculture, and what Charles would like to do about it when he took up his seat in the Lords one day. Sadie was striding along in her usual way, swishing at the verges with a stick she'd somehow managed to pick up. Diana thought about what she would be able to do for Sadie when she was Lady Dean, bringing her out properly, teaching her how to behave, the right clothes, meeting the right people. She could make sure Sadie made a good marriage. She would have her to stay with them as often as possible. It was a cheering thought. She'd not previously considered the power to help others that would come with her title.
As she watched Charles talking to Sadie, marrying him seemed less daunting. Certainly he did not smile and joke and tease in the easy way her other suitors had done, but she could imagine him at the other side of the breakfast table, politely pouring her coffee and telling her what he had planned for the day. Not fun, but dignity was what she could expect from this union. She lifted her chin a little and smiled graciously as Hicks, their postman, touched his cap to them. And across the road, Alicia Harding and Lizzie Drake stared enviously. They would come to call later, she knew, to tell Diana again how lucky she was. It was all quite gratifying. Naylor left them, in his sudden way, disappearing under a hedge.
"He says he has important business," Sadie explained.
"I had a terrier a bit like him when I was a boy," Charles said.
"What was his name?" Sadie asked.
"Rags. He was a fiery little fellow."
"Was he always getting into fights?"
"He used to fight with my sister's French poodle."
"Well, one can understand that," said Sadie. "There's such a thing as self-respect."
Charles made no response to this. Sadie wished silently for John Corsi, who would have picked up the comment and made fun with it. Charles was nice, she thought, but rather hard work. She tried a new tack.
"Have you had any news about going to France? Diana said you thought it might be in January, but here we are halfway through."
"We did think that," Charles agreed. "Now they're saying it might be February. But we know nothing for sure. I'm afraid we survive on rumour and hope."
"You must be anxious to be going," Sadie said.
"The men are itching to be off," Charles said. "They're tired of training. They feel they're absolutely ready and can't understand the delays."
"And are they ready?" Diana asked.
"The old hands are. But we were nowhere near full strength when the war broke out, and about a fifth of our men are new volunteers who've only been with us a few weeks. We've been knocking them into shape as fast as we can."
He paused as if in doubt.
"However," he went on more surely, "we'll manage all right, once we're out there. They're all splendid fellows."
"When do you think it'll be over?" Diana asked. "The war, I mean." "It was supposed to be over by Christmas," Sadie put in. "Now I hear people say next Christmas."
"Well," Charles said, "even once we've beaten them, mopping up will take time. The spring of 1916, I should say, at the earliest."
Diana said, "That seems so far away."
"Yes," he said.
Sadie dropped behind to look at something in the hedge, and he added in a low voice,
"It was the most wretched luck, this war coming, just when I'd finally met you. I wish..."
He didn't seem to have the words to finish that. Diana felt a little thrill of warmth. He so rarely referred to his feelings for her. "But," she said at last, "we will be married before then."
He looked down at her. "Of course we will. We talked about June, didn't we?"
He hesitated.
"For myself, I'd like to marry you at once. A lot of our fellows have had a register office wedding, to be sure of fitting it in before we go abroad."
Diana was dismayed.
"Oh, I don't think I'd like that. Wouldn't it seem, well, rather make do?"
If he was disappointed, he hid it.
"Oh, quite," he said. "Besides, my mother would never countenance it. You shall have a proper wedding."
He added awkwardly, "I'd like you always to have everything you want." Sadie rejoined them, so there was no opportunity for Diana to pursue this happy thought.
"It's starting to rain," Sadie said, holding out her hand.
A large drop fell obediently onto it.
"It'll be cats and dogs in a minute. Good job you brought a brolly."
"It's not really big enough for three," Diana said, with a frown. Charles would be sure to insist the two girls used it, and she didn't want to walk arm in arm with Sadie. She could do that any time.
"We'd better take shelter."
Charles glanced around. Sadie was disappointed to see his eye pass over the Windmill Cafe. It alighted instead on Everton's photographic studio next door.
"Would you come and have your photograph taken with me?" he asked Diana. "I'd love to have one to keep in my pocketbook."
Diana was pleased and touched.
"I'd like that too," she said. "I think I'll go home then," Sadie said.
"You'll get wet," Diana said reprovingly.
"I don't mind," said Sadie. "Anyway, my hat's jolly strong, and there are trees nearly all the way."
And with a smile to Charles, she was away. The rain suddenly arrived. Diana and Charles ducked into Everton's, where two soldiers with their female friends were about the same errand. As soon as they saw an officer, they jumped out of the way and effaced themselves, begging him to take their turn.
Mr. Eventon reinforced the request, gesturing Diana with a bow towards a chair. After a short discussion, he changed the backdrop to a Tuscan landscape, arranged a red velvet armchair and a parlour palm in a pot, and invited Charles to sit while Diana stood with her left hand, gloveless, on his shoulder, showing the ring. Charles did not like to sit while a lady stood, but Eventon explained that as he was so much taller than Miss Hunter, this would make a better composition. The photograph was taken, and Charles ordered 2 at 3 inches by 2, what Eventon called wallet size, one each for himself and Diana, and 2 12 by 8s, one for each of the sets of parents. He paid for them in advance and asked for them to be delivered to Miss Hunter when they were ready, as I'm not sure where I shall be.
Oh, quite, sir,
Eventon agreed, this being not an unusual set of circumstances in his world. But the words struck Diana, and she was silent, contemplating the sobering truth of them. Just for a moment, she wondered if it wouldn't have been better to marry quickly at a register office after all. Chapter 3 Ada had a cold, and when she got a cold, she always got earache.
"I've always been subject to ears," she said miserably, "ever since I was a child."
"Nasty things, ears," cook said, as she packed the offending orifices with cotton wool soaked in warmed oil of cloves, her patent remedy. "You don't want to take chances with them."
Emily, leaning her elbows on the table and watching the process with interest, said,
"There was a girl back home died of an earwig in her ear."
"Don't tell such stories," cook reproved her.
Emily looked hurt.
"'Tis true. An earwig got in her ear while she was asleep, and it ate its way right into her brain, and she went mad and dashed her head against a wall and killed herself." "What's she saying?"
asked Ada.
"Nothing. Go and wash up those breakfast things, Emily," cook said sternly. "No one's interested in your silly tales."
Emily dragged herself slowly upright, then was galvanised by the sound of a bell.
"Back door," she cried,
and was off.
"That girl," said cook.
The bell sounded again. Cook looked at the board.
"Front door now."
Ada started to rise.
"You stay put. Keep out the draught. Let Ethel go."
"She's upstairs. I'll do it," said Ada, and went.
She opened the front door to a thin elderly man carrying a parcel done up with brown paper and string. He had a clerical collar peeping out from the neck of his overcoat. He lifted his hat politely and offered his card.
"May I speak with your mistress?" he said, trying not to stare at the cotton wool. Collecting for something, Ada thought, but she couldn't leave a man of the cloth standing outside.
She admitted him to the hall and went to the morning room where Beatty was writing letters. Newly deaf, she had no idea how loudly she was speaking, so Ethel, coming downstairs, quite clearly heard her say,
"The Reverend Mr. Treadgold asking to see you, madam."
Ethel's foot froze in midair, and she backed up a few steps until she was hidden by the turn.
What was he doing here?
In the morning room, Beatty received the visitor patiently, suspecting, like Ada, that he was collecting for something, though his card said he was from Holy Trinity, Gosford, so he was casting his net rather wide. Still, Gosford was a small place, and perhaps his local geese had all been plucked out.
"How can I help you?" she asked,
but without asking him to sit down. She managed not to stare at the parcel he was clutching.
"Are you the lady of the house? I beg your pardon, but I do not know your name," Mr. Treadgold said.
Beatty chilled a fraction. He looked the image of a clergyman, lean of face, silver hair, gold-rimmed pince-nez, coat collar a little worn, boots old but well kept. But that did not prove his bona fides.
"I am Mrs. Hunter," she said.
He waved a hand, embarrassed. "You must think it very odd of me to call in this way. I do beg your pardon, but it is a Christian mission, of that I do assure you. I'm looking for a Miss Lusby, a Miss Ethel Lusby, and I was informed that she resided at this address."
Oh, Lord, now what's she done? Beatty thought.
"She's a housemaid here," she told him, and saw enlightenment creep over his face. "Perhaps you'd better sit down, Mr. Treadgold, and tell me what it is you want." 5 minutes later, she rang the bell, and when Ada answered, told her to send Ethel in. There seemed a longish delay, as though Ethel could not be found, but eventually the door opened and the maid came in, her chin defiant and her eyes apprehensive. "Ethel, this gentleman is the Reverend Mr. Treadgold from Gosford. He wants to talk to you," Beattie said, in a gentle tone. Ethel said nothing. Treadgold rose and stepped towards her.
"I don't suppose you remember me," he said. "You must have been a small child when I last spoke to you, though I have seen you passing once or twice when you've come to the village to visit your mother."
Ethel's gaze sharpened and her lips tightened, but she said nothing.
"Least said, soonest mended," was her motto. "I'm afraid I have some very sad news for you, my child," Treadgold went on. "Your mother has passed away. I'm sure you know she had been ill for quite a long time, so you should look upon this as a blessed release."
Ethel blinked, but all she said, turning her head slightly towards Beattie, was,
"Will that be all, madam?"
Beattie looked at her, puzzled.
"Do you understand what the gentleman said?" "Yes, madam."
"I understood that her neighbour, Mrs. Clark, had sent a note to you informing you,"
Treadgold pursued, "but perhaps it went astray. I have one or two things I have been holding for you, thinking you would be coming to collect them, but when you did not, things belonging to your mother."
He gestured towards the parcel on the table by the sofa. Ethel said nothing, and her eyes were fixed straight ahead. Treadgold examined her doubtfully. Reactions to this news, which he'd often had to impart in the course of his duties, had been many and varied, but this was the oddest. A thought occurred to him.
"She was buried on the parish, my dear, there being no money to pay for a funeral, but it was very reverently conducted. I undertook the ceremony myself, and the plot is in a quiet part of the churchyard, over by the old mulberry tree. There is no stone, of course, but any time you wish to visit, I or the sexton can show you where it is. There will be no question of recovering the expense from you, I assure you."
Still nothing from Ethel. Treadgold smiled apologetically at Beattie.
"Perhaps I'd better take my leave. No, dear lady, don't trouble to ring. I can see myself out. Good day to you, and my apologies again for disturbing you."
Ethel seemed on the verge of following him, but Beattie called her back. Now the girl merely looked sulky at being detained, but Beattie tried to be kind.
"I'm sorry to hear this, Ethel. I had no idea your mother lived in Gosford. You never mentioned her." "She wasn't my mother," Ethel said fiercely. "She was..."
The ferocity died away.
"Just the person who brought me up."
"Well," said Beattie, "that's the same thing, really, isn't it?" Ethel's look asserted it wasn't, by a long chalk, but she said nothing. Beattie gave up.
"Very well," she said. "You may go. And again, I'm very sorry."
Ethel turned away.
"Take your parcel," Beattie reminded her. "I don't want it," Ethel said, without turning.
Beattie's lips tightened.
"Take it, please," she said.
In the voice maids didn't disobey. Ethel picked it up, as though it might bite, and left the room. Outside, she found she was trembling. She looked at the parcel and wanted to fling it from her, like something loathsome. But in the end, curiosity won, and she carried it up to the room she shared with Ada. Sitting on her bed, she untied the string and unwrapped the paper. Inside was a cardboard box, and inside that. She picked out the crumpled newspaper that had been used to pack the items, and drew out the china shepherd that had stood on Ma's mantelpiece. He had a crack down his face, and no nose and a chip off his base. Obviously one of a pair, he'd lost his shepherdess back in the mists of time, perhaps before Ma had even acquired him. He was grubby too, from 1,000 smoky fires. Vicar could have saved himself the bother, she thought, bringing the mouldy old thing all this way. Second item, Ma's tea caddy, a square black tin with Union Jacks on the sides and a picture of Queen Victoria on the lid, with the words Golden Jubilee above and the dates below. She opened it. It smelt of tea, but there was none in there. That old thief, Mrs. Clark, must have emptied it. Wonder she didn't take the tin as well. Maybe she'd thought Ethel would miss it. Some hopes. Third item, a little brown milk jug. It was so familiar to Ethel that tears actually pricked her eyes. It had stood in the coolest place in the scullery and always had a round muslin cover weighted with little blue beads to keep the flies out. When Ethel was tiny,
She'd sometimes put the muslin circle on her head and pretended it was a veil or a hat or a crown. In a life starved of beauty, she'd thought the blue beads the loveliest thing she'd ever seen and imagined them threaded into a necklace. She rummaged among the newspapers, but the cover was not there. Ethel stared at the three objects, Ma's total accumulated riches. She felt tears prickling again and would not cry them. Not for that woman, who had never said a kind word to her in all her life. Three pieces of rubbish, that was all there was to show that Annie Lusby had ever lived. No, wait. She threw out all the rest of the crumpled newspaper, and there was something else, lying flat on the bottom underneath it. Three envelopes, tied up with a thin piece of string. She stared at them, as though they were a snake that might strike. Turning her head sideways, she could see the postmark, Northampton, and the handwriting, clumsy and untutored, addressed to Annie Lusby, 2 Dedis Row, Gosford. She knew who they were from. There was no one in the world who would write to Annie Lusby except her daughter Edie, no one in the world who knew she existed, apart from Edie and Ethel. She finally got up the courage to pick up the bundle and held it in her lap, staring at it. 3 letters, only 3. But inside, what? Why had Annie kept them? Did they tell something important, or had she just forgotten to throw them out? At least, Ethel thought, there would be an address in there, Edie's address, a way to trace her, and ask her. She shook herself. She didn't want what was in these envelopes. She opened the top drawer of her chest, and with a repelling movement thrust them inside, under the clothes, and slammed it shut. She'd get rid of them later, when there wasn't anyone to see and ask questions. You're dead, Annie. She addressed the shade of the milk jug. You can't do anything to me now. She heard thumping feet on the stairs, and Emily appeared in the doorway, panting. Whatever are you doing up here? Cook sent me. She wants you right away. All right, said Ethel. Emily's eyes went to the objects on the bed, and her face lit. Oh, would you look at the darling little man. Isn't he a treasure? Where'd you get it? I never saw it before. Ethel didn't want any questions. She picked up the shepherd. Do you want it? You can have it if you like. Emily looked suspicious. What's the trick? No trick. I'm trying to be nice, that's all. Do you mean it? I can have it. Emily took it flinchingly, and when it didn't explode or bite or cut her, her thin face curved into a smile. Thank you, she breathed. She stroked the damaged china face. Oh, isn't he a love? The handsome prince. It's not a prince, it's a shepherd, Ethel said impatiently. Emily was going daft again. He's a prince, Emily insisted dreamily. He looks exactly like somebody. He's my prince, and he'll come on his white horse and take me away. Someone will come and take you away, that's for sure, Ethel said, shoving her out of the way as she went out. And it'll be in a van. Downstairs, Cook gave Ethel a suspicious look as she came in. What was you sent for to the morning room? You in trouble? Ethel didn't answer. Emily said you wanted me urgent. I want you to do the bread and butter. Ethel moved towards the table. Well? Cook insisted. Well, what? There was some clergyman came to see the missus and you were sent for. Had a parcel when he arrived, no parcel when he left. What was in it? Emily chirped up. Oh, there was a lovely little... Ethel pinched her hard and the sentence ended in a small squeak. It was just some things, Ethel said, seeing some answer had to be given. An old woman died that lived in Gosford. She left me some things and Vicar brought them, that's all. Who do you know in Gosford? Cook demanded. What old woman? Nobody you knew. Don't you be pert with me, Cook said. You're up to something. I know that look. Ethel shrugged. A person's got a right to have things, if a person leaves them to her. How many slices you want? Emily, Cook said sternly. What was in that parcel? Emily squirmed, looking sidelong at Ethel. Ah, no, don't ask me. Sure, I don't want to say, and she'll pinch me again. Cook fixed her with a gimlet eye, and she said,
"'Twas a little Chinaman. Ever so lovely. And Ethel gave him to me. I swear to God she did. I never took him, and there was a little jug. That's all I saw, honest."
Cook shook her head, looked at Ethel, head bent over the loaf and knife, and gave it up.
"If I find you're in trouble and haven't told me," she said warningly, "no need to cut so thin, it's only our lunch. Emily, get the jam out and lay the table. Ada, fetch the cake tin."
There wasn't time to investigate now. Mump would be in any minute, and the missus had two ladies coming for luncheon. She'd have a go at Emily later. You could always make Emily talk. That girl's tongue had wheels both ends. Sadie was woken on her birthday by Ada with a smile and a tray. Sadie sat up and saw there was a cup of tea and a plate bearing a slice of bread and butter.
"Oh, Ada," she said, moved. "I've never had tea in bed before. It's just like you read about at country house weekends." "Just this once. It's a special day," Ada said. "Happy birthday, Miss Sadie. 17. You're a young lady now."
So John Corsi had also said.
"I don't feel any different," she said. "Give it time," said Ada, going out.
She passed Diana in the doorway.
"What's going on?"
Diana said.
"I heard voices."
Her front hair was in rags, and she was wearing her most unglamorous but warm dressing gown, inherited from David. Yet still, Sadie noted wistfully, she looked beautiful.
"What's that?"
Diana went on, staring at the tray.
"Tea in bed?" "Because it's my birthday," Sadie explained. "Birthday? Oh, I'd forgotten. Wait a minute," Diana said, and whisked away.
She was soon back with a small tissue-wrapped object in her hand.
"For you," she said.
She climbed up onto Sadie's bed and tucked her feet under her.
"Goodness, it's cold in here. I wish Father would let us have fires in the bedrooms. When I'm married, I'm going to have a fire in my bedroom all the time."
"Oh, so grand," Sadie teased.
There wasn't even a fireplace in her room, which was the smallest of the bedrooms.
"I suppose you'll have tea in bed every day as well." "That's what's done in great houses," Diana said loftily. "They always have tea and bread and butter, and then their maids run their baths. Aren't you going to open it?"
Sadie put down the cup from which she'd been sipping appreciatively and turned her attention to the present. She unwrapped it slowly, wanting to make it last, a habit that always annoyed Diana.
"I saw it in the window of Tinnington's last week and thought it was just right for you," Diana said.
She made an exasperated noise.
"Open it! Open it!"
It was a small brooch, made of mother-of-pearl, in the shape of a rose.
"Oh, it's lovely," Sadie cried. "Thank you so much. You are kind."
"It's about time you had some jewellery," Diana said, absently eating Sadie's bread and butter. "You're not a child any more now, you know. You'll have to start dressing properly and behaving like a lady." She shivered.
"I'm going back to my room. It's so cold in here."
She took the other half slice with her and left. Sadie drank the tea, putting the brooch on the tray so she could admire it. It was funny that when Ada had said she was a young lady, it had sounded like a treat. But when Diana had said it, it had sounded like a threat. And then she reflected that it was interesting how those two words, which were opposites, were the same except for the letter H. Birthdays were not made a great deal of in the Hunter household, but there were presents for Sadie at breakfast. A new pair of riding breeches from her parents and a book, jointly from Bobby, William and Peter, called The Horse in Sickness and Health. And beside her plate were cards from the Carberries in Kildare, the Porphyries, Aunt Laura and Cousin Beth. She noted, with a little pang, that David had not sent one. She'd thought he might have, as he was not at home. Perhaps something might come in the second delivery. But whatever anyone might have intended, Sadie's birthday was completely overshadowed by the newspapers, which had arrived since Ada brought her the cup of tea, and which were full of the awful events of the night before. Two German airships had crept silently across the North Sea under cover of darkness and dropped bombs on the sleeping towns of Great Yarmouth, Sheringham and King's Lynn, and their surrounding villages. At least 4 people had been killed, with many more injured, and thousands of pounds worth of damage had been done. The papers enjoyed in the kitchen were full of sensational reports. Awful photographs of blasted houses, and spine-chilling prognostications of horrors to come. Cook was completely undone. Ever since the Germans had shelled Scarborough and other East Coast towns on the 16th of December, she'd been in fear of an invasion. But this was in some ways worse. At least you could have a go at an invader. Even if it was hopeless, you could go down fighting. But what could you do about bombs dropped on you from the air, especially in the dead of night? The idea of being killed in your sleep by an enemy you'd never even see was horripilating.
"You can't hear 'em coming," she said, quivering over the Daily Mail. "Silent death, that's what they call it."
"Not so silent when they explodes," said Munt, who had called in for a cup of tea to take to his shed. He'd
come to work early to get away from home, where his wife was equally overthrown by the news, only to find the same scene here.
"Make a bloody big noise then, wouldn't they, when they're a-blowing of you to bits?"
"It's too late then, isn't it?" Cook countered. "If you could hear the Zeppelins coming, you could run away. Now we'll all be killed in our beds. Why don't they do something about it? They have to cross the sea, don't they? Why don't the Navy shoot them down?"
"Toast's burning," Ethel said, coming in with the coffee pot to refill. Cook was still glued to the newspaper, and it was Ada who said,
"Emily, stop daydreaming and mind that toast. You'll have to scrape that for us and put some more on for the dining room."
"Weren't there supposed to be mushrooms?" Ethel said, peering at the stove. Cook roused herself at last from the horrors.
"Oh, Lord, I forgot. Quick, pass me that saucepan. I'll have to do them unpeeled. They taste better that way," she comforted herself.
Later, when their own breakfast had been eaten, Ethel, succumbing to the relentless topic over a second cup of tea, said,
"I can't see why they want to bomb Sheringham and Great Yarmouth anyway. They're just seaside places, aren't they?"
"To strike terror into our hearts, my girl, that's why," said Cook.
"They probably got blown off course," said Ada. "That's what the butcher's boy said. Probably meant to bomb the docks at Hull and lost their way in the dark."
"But that only makes it worse," Emily said. "If they can't even hit the things they want to hit, none of us is safe."
Henry, the boot boy, had arrived and joined in eagerly.
"They don't want us to be safe," he said. "My dad says they're going to bomb the whole country. Kill everybody near as they can so they can walk in and take over. It's cheaper than fighting with the army, my dad says. Them Zeps can fly so high nobody can't shoot them down, and they'll just come night after night a-bombing of us until we're all dead."
Emily gave a little shriek, and Cook, though she blanched at the thought, felt he'd gone too far.
"Never mind what your dad says. Just get started on last night's knives and don't talk so much. Emily, clear the table."
Mrs. Chaplin, the charwoman, came in that day and brought more information from her son, who was the blacksmith on Russington Road.
"My Jack says they've known this was coming for ages, ever since the New Year. They say Mr. Churchill reckons there'll be a big raid on the Kaiser's birthday. 100 Zeppelins coming to bomb London."
"And when might that be?" Ada asked.
27th of January, said Mrs. Chaplin. "Jack says rich people in London are sending their children away to be safe."
"Safe where?" Cook said. "Nowhere safe from things that can fly like that."
"How do they see where to go in the dark?" Emily asked.
"From the lights down below," said Mrs. Chaplin, their new expert. "Street lamps and people's houses and such like. When you're up in the sky and everything's dark, the lights stand out like anything."
"I heard," said Henry, lingering by the scullery door, "they got German spies in England what signalled the Zeps with their car headlights to show 'em where to bomb."
"My Jack heard that too," said Mrs. Chaplin.
Henry nodded portentously.
"Anyone can see out in a car at night. He could be a German spy, signalling the Zeps to come. And I heard there's people live by the seaside what flashes their lights on and off at night so the Zeps know where the coastline is. There's spies everywhere," he concluded round-eyed.
"My Jack says the same. He says we all got to be on our guard. But it comes to something when you're not safe in your own home,"
Mrs. Chaplin said indignantly.
"The government ought to do something about it."
Chapter 4. Mrs. Fitzgerald refused coffee.
No, thank you, my dear.
I have a great deal to do this morning. She did sit down, however, casting a sharp look around the morning room, as if to discover what Beatty had been doing before her arrival. Beatty folded her hands and tried not to look guilty.
I've come to speak to you about the Zeppelins, Mrs. Fitzgerald went on. The rector feels very strongly that should the invaders come here, we must have a means of warning our people to take shelter. As you know, the bells of All Hallows have been silenced for the duration of the war, but the rector feels that an exception should be made for a toxin.
A toxin? Beatty said vaguely, thinking of poisons. The tenor and treble rung together as a warning. Now, of course, our ringers have volunteered for the army, Mrs. Fitzgerald said. They had gone all together to join as pals, which was the real reason the rector had silenced the peal, making a virtue of necessity. We have old Mr. Fields, our reserve ringer, but he's getting rather frail, and it would take him some time to get out his bicycle and ride to the church. So I'm hoping to recruit a number of young ringers, prepared to take on the duty, should the worst happen.
Oh, Mother, please, can I?
It was William, lingering at the door in his scout uniform, on his way to the Saturday meeting.
You don't know how to ring a bell, Beatty said, frowning at him for eavesdropping, though the door was open, and he'd probably come to say goodbye.
Fields will train the new ringers, Mrs. Fitzgerald said. There will be no great skill required, simply to pull the rope without hurting themselves or damaging the bell. Then please can I? William begged. You know us scouts are supposed to make ourselves useful and help the war effort.
He saw himself sleeping in the bell chamber every night, keeping watch from the top of the tower, spotting the looming menace and rushing down to save the village by his vigorous ringing. In an ambitious extension, he saw himself having a medal pinned on him by the king.
Well done, my boy. You're an example to us all, said His Majesty. Youthful hero saves hundreds, was the headline in the newspaper the next day.
I'm afraid you won't do as a ringer, said Mrs. Fitzgerald, shattering the dream. Suppose a zeppelin came when you were at school. You would not be able to reach the church in time.
I thought the zeppelins came by night, said Beatty.
So far they have, but we have no idea how they may operate in the future. The essence of the toxin ringers is that they must be close to the church at all times. So I've come to ask you if I may have your boot boy, Henry. He seems to be a strong enough lad, and working here and living in Lychgate Close, he will be always on hand.
You can ask him, of course, Beatty said, aware of a faint groan of disappointment from the doorway. But I'm not sure that you'll find him very reliable.
We can knock him into shape, said Mrs. Fitzgerald, with a certain relish. I shall, of course, recruit more than two ringers to allow for absences, probably six or eight, to be on the safe side.
Yes, well, said Beatty, let's hope the necessity never arrives.
Indeed, said Mrs. Fitzgerald, rising to leave, but one must be prepared.
Isn't that not the scouting motto, William?
She ruffled his hair kindly as she passed, and William bore it very well, considering the time he'd just spent slicking it down with water in an attempt to look like Wallace Reed. Henry enjoyed a brief moment of celebrity in the kitchen after his first visit to the bell tower to be instructed by Mr. Fields. Fields was a familiar figure around Northcote. He was not only a ringer and former sexton, but, as a veteran of the Crimean and Sudan campaigns, with medals to prove it, he'd become latterly a self-proclaimed expert on war. His comforting contention was that the British soldier could not be beaten, and since the current conflict had broken out, he'd been stood many a pint of beer by those who wanted reassurance.
He took us all over the tower, Henry said. The ringing chamber first, but then up to see the bells and all. Gore, that wasn't half good. You have to climb up this ladder and it's all dark and creepy, like in Frankenstein at the pictures, and the barrels are so big and kind of creepy too, like they was looking at you.
Daft, said Ethel scornfully.
No, but it was sort of interesting, Henry protested. Mr. Fields told us a lot about them. They've all got names. The big one's called Big Tom, and the other one we'll have to ring is Little Pen. They're the lowest and the highest, so you'll hear 'em better. And there's stuff carved on 'em, like mottos.
He struggled to remember the mottos, wanting to make the most of his audience while he had it. But the language was out of his usual experience, so it had not stuck. Munt, who had been a ringer in his time, could have told him that the great tenor, which was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.